Hey, Teo here, at it once again. Today's video is probably going to be a little bit on the short end, but we'll see how much of door 7 we can knock out. See what horrible traumas Michael went through in his childhood. Man, how hilarious would it be if his childhood was just, like, completely normal, like, and relatively happy? I mean, obviously that doesn't sync up with the point where we first meet him, but how much of a twist would that be? It's like we go in expecting like horrible things to happen, and then just nothing horrible happens. It's just super mundane. That would be super funny. It wouldn't make any sense. So I'm glad they're not going to do it. It'd be super funny. There were two things out of the ordinary about that baby. The first, its parents embraced, and the second, they wholly rejected. Although, it was some time before the baby's second peculiarity emerged, and until it finally did, no one was any the wiser. Not even the child itself. Its mother surely enjoyed that brief period of happiness. Before her child finally realized the truth. Blind to the fact that the moment it had let out its first cry, everything came crashing down. To this day, she still doesn't know the child she gave birth to. That she let loose a curse upon the world. A curse that turned angels into demons, humans into witches. My god, look at that. She's beautiful, isn't she? Have you seen her laugh? Not yet, I haven't. At any rate, that color certainly is something else. God's gift to us. No, she's an angel sent from heaven. An angel. Ah yes, I can see it now, Liddy. Lighty? Liddy? Her white hair and almost translucent skin, it's beautiful. Aye, she opened her eyes. Maybe she felt you nearby. Do you like your father more than me? Is that it, sweetheart? Gorgeous, aren't they? Such a deep, enchanting color. Like two little jewels. Ah, that they are. A magnificent shade of red. I've never seen anything like it. And this is our child. She's special. I can feel it. We have to take good care of her. She needs a name. One that's just as special as her. Have you already chosen, Antonin? You were the one begging for a girl. You do it. Besides, I already had to rack my brain for the boys' names. Now it's your turn. Are you really going to let me? My, that's quite a lot of pressure. Name her after an angel, then. Oh, I like that. Alright, then. We'll call her Michelle, after the Archangel Michael. You'll grow up to be as beautiful as an angel, my Michelle. I've always wanted a little girl. With her snowy white hair, skin so pale you could see the veins beneath it, and her ruby red eyes, she was a very peculiar-looking little girl, and her mother showered her with love. She truly believed her daughter was an angel sent from above, born as a human child. The blessed babe, born a girl, was given an angel's name. Michelle. Me. Checkmate. I see. That's what you did. Curses, I completely overlooked that. I thought you were advancing with your pawns, but that was all a diversion. You're too short-sighted, Didier. You need to look at the big picture. Sometimes, it's the tactician, not the soldier holding the sword. Haha, you got me. You're quite good at this, Michelle. What inspired you to take such an aggressive strategy? It was not inspiration. It was derivation. Derivation? Chess is in many ways similar to real war tactics. Ah, my military texts. You haven't read all of them, have you? I have nothing but time. Impressive. Even I haven't read all the books in my room. You planning to join the Order with that kind of knowledge? Jest. You're the one who's going to be a knight, Didier. Ha, that I am. War is the men's job, after all. You, I want you to be there to welcome me home. Didier. Oh, Didier. I'm in a bit of a bind. Oh, hello there, Michelle. I didn't know you were home, Georges. Just got back, yep. Oh-ho, playing chess again, are ya? Let's see, what do we have here? Get away from the board. Yikes, you got trounced, huh? And you call yourself her big brother. As if you're any better. That's not funny, Georges. I cannot approve of someone who can't keep up with the flow of battle becoming a knight. Given our family's rank, you'd eventually be put in charge of other soldiers. What, are you worried about me? No, I'm saying... I've been blessed with such a caring sister. But fear not. I have a guardian angel, after all. Where's the logic in that? Sorry to interrupt your moment, but... Does nobody listen to me? Now, don't pout. So, what seems to be the problem, Georges? Ah, yes, listen to this. The Royal Court is holding a swordsmanship to show, and for some reason, I was selected to participate. How unfortunate for you. I can already see you on the ground sobbing. Hey now, that's just mean! Besides, my hand weren't meant to hold a sword. Look at these dainty fingers. They're covered in calluses. Dainty calluses! Don't think calluses can be dainty. I don't think that works. Tell me, why would they have an artist sword fight? That's the whole point, I would think. No need to get so worked up. No one's expecting you to win. Maybe not, but we do have a name to worry about. And you know what that means, don't you? I'm going to lose, that's a given, but I want to do it in style. I feel bad for your sword. Oh, don't be like that. Now come on, time's a-wastin'. To the courtyard we go. Just so you know, if I train you, I'm going to train you right. All I want to know is how to look good. What is it, Michelle? May I watch? Fine with me, but you know you can't go outside. I'll be watching from the hall. I can open one of the windows facing the courtyard. Still, you need to be careful. You can't spend too much time in the sun. I know. I had two older brothers. The eldest, Didier, belonged to an order of knights that served the church. And below him was Georges, who served as a court artist. He was, in all likelihood, would inherit the family estate, as knights were not formally allowed to own property. Nevertheless, the Bollinger family name was upheld by Didier. And then there was me, the youngest, the only daughter. Physically, I was not in particularly good health. Because of the color of my skin, I was hypersensitive to sunlight. I rarely left the estate. My world was contained entirely within these walls. And perhaps out of some sense of pity or compassion, my two brothers spent a good deal of time with me. Didier played chess with me, and Georges taught me how to draw. And among other things, they taught me how to read and write. For a girl, I was incredibly fortunate. The one thing I wasn't allowed to do, though, was hold a sword. While hardly anything unusual, it bothered me deeply. And it had for as long as I could remember. If I had been told I couldn't do it because I lacked the strength, I probably would have accepted it. But the reason given was not that I was weak, but that I was a girl. And with each passing year, the smoldering frustration in the back of my heart grew larger. Come on, put your back into it. Like I said, all I want to do is put on a good show. Oh, you'll put on quite a show. Unless you learn how to swing that sword properly. Give me a break! Out in the garden, my two brothers traded swings bare-chested. All I could do, though, was observe from afar. And every time I found myself forced to watch, I felt a sharp pain, like a needle piercing my chest. A needle that seemed to be growing ever thicker. My mother and my brothers loved me dearly, but that didn't change the fact that the outside world lay beyond my reach. I was trapped in the estate by my own body. At first, I thought that was the root of my pain. But that answer seemed to contradict something inside me, something I couldn't explain, something I couldn't ignore, even as a child. So I searched within myself, trying to find an explanation for the constantly swelling sensation of wrongness inside me. Day after day, I gazed into the cavern of my own heart. My. Now what are the two of them doing out there? Georges was asked to do a swordsmanship show at the royal court, so Didier's helping him. Swordsmanship? Oh, I just can't stand those shows. Blades are so dangerous. I can't watch people swinging them at each other. Why don't you come back to your room with me, Michelle? I would love to teach you how to sew. But Mom, I want to watch them practice. Michelle? First of all, you need to watch how you speak, young lady. You do not call me Mom, you call me Mother. This is what happens when you spend so much time around boys. As your mother, I don't approve of you playing chess or making art. A woman has no need for such skills. They will only make you look insolent. But I want you to grow up to be a respectable woman. That is my job and my dream as your mother. Now come. I would rather you look at some fine embroidery with me than a couple of sweaty men. Yes, Mother. You are my little girl, after all. Spending time with my mother was agonizing. Was it because her world was so isolated? No, that wasn't it. Her gentle voice, the sweet scent of her perfume, the way she constantly told me how much she loved me, and her diatribes about how wonderful it was to be a girl. Everything she did put so much pressure on me. And above all, she loved to say, "You are my little girl, after all." And there was nothing strange about that at all. Every time I looked in the mirror, I saw the daughter of a noble. That was who I was. So the only thing wrong was how I felt. But every time I was faced with the reality of who I was, my heart wavered. I had no interest in learning to embroider. I didn't understand why that was necessary. I knew what purpose it served. Everything she taught me I would need when I was wed off to some noble boy, and it was my responsibility to learn those things. It didn't feel right, though. I couldn't accept the fact that one day I would be married. It was but an ominous shadow lurking in my future. I would prefer ravaging the books in Didier's room than having a conversation with my mother. Tales of heroes of old and dauntless soldiers. Military texts written by tacticians in the midst of war. Thinking about them set my heart aflutter and made me think about my brother. He was training to be a knight. I envisioned armor flecked with rust, a longsword glimmering with the blood of savages. Soon, I found myself in my fantasies, imagining how the sword would feel in my hands. The sensation of a hilt beneath my fingers, swinging it gallantly, like my brother. How heavy was it? How much muscle would I need to carry it? How much impact would I feel in my hands when I struck something? How restricted would my vision be wearing a helmet? How much did it weigh? How hot was it inside? I had no way of answering any of those questions, though.
Kill me now!
I have some cloth, if you'd like to wipe yourself off. Oh, yeah, thanks.
Oh, I'm so dead.
You were at it for a long time. I've never known Dee to half-ass something once he gets started. Which, I guess, is what makes him knight material, but... Are you opposed to him becoming a knight? Well, you know, I kinda assumed he'd inherit the estate and handle taking care of everything. So it's like, why's he gotta go and be some priest's whipping boy? Don't tell him I said that, though. He wants to fight for the greater good. I don't know. Despite the name, he wouldn't be doing much fighting himself. Anywho, someone as passionate as him might be able to make changes for the better. Changes? He knows what condition the Order is in. That's why he's joining. Figure he wants to whip him into shape, melt him down, and reforge the whole thing. Heh. Huh. So he might be able to change things. What? What are you muttering about, Michelle? Hey, whoa! Hold it! The pain I felt in my chest when I smelled the sweat emanating from George's body, when I looked at his slender but distinctly male build, I was convinced it was admiration. Did I want to become a knight, too? Maybe the discomfort I felt was because I wanted to be like him. Would it all go away if he were able to change the rules and I could join the Order as well? I was positive it would. Didier. Michelle? Hold on. You can't come barging in my room unannounced. I'm trying to change. We need to talk. I said, stop! You're a girl. You can't just walk in on a man as he's changing. I see no reason for you to be so self-conscious. Listen to me, Michelle. George tells me you're planning to overhaul the Order. He told you that? No, I hardly have such grand aspirations. Don't be coy. I believe you have what it takes to do it, Didier. What's good, Nandi? What's gotten into you? You're unusually fiery today. So I want to ask you a favor. When you have enough influence in the Order, I would like you to make me a knight, too. You what? I'm tired of the way Mother treats me, always saying I can't do this or that because I'm a girl. I want to learn how to swing a sword. I don't want to do embroidery. I don't care about jewelry or fancy clothing. Michelle, what's gotten into you? I'm so much more interested in the world you live in, Didier. So please. Well, I'll be. I suppose we must let ourselves spend too much time with you. Not you too. It's exactly what Mother said. First of all, Michelle, you don't have the strength to hold a sword. Then I'll train until I do. And if that doesn't work, I still have my mind. You know good and well I could... People are not chess pieces, Michelle. Didier! But above all, you're missing the most important part. I will not, for any reason, become the kind of man who makes a woman take up a sword. Makes and, like, enables are very different verbs. Didier, this may seem normal to you, growing up with two brothers, but I want you to listen to me, Michelle. Men and women walk different paths. Men wield swords and fight against dangerous enemies, and they do so to protect the weak, women and children. I'm here to protect you and your mother. No different than her. You don't treat me any different than her. Honestly, what's gotten into you, Michelle? Why wouldn't I treat you like a daughter of the Bollinger Estate? Your brother and I, we never meant to make you think... Forget it. What? I'm sorry. I knew what I was asking was foolish. Oh? But I thought you would understand how I feel. Even just a little bit. What was I expecting him to understand? Even I didn't understand the things I felt. I wanted to know what had gotten into me far more than he did. What I had done was no better than throw a temper tantrum. Was I that desperate to become a knight? No. I just thought that the key to the change in my heart lay down that road, but ultimately, there was nothing. Assuming Didier had agreed, and assuming I did become a knight, it wouldn't do anything for the core problem. As I dashed from my brother's room, I snuck a peek at him. His face was filled with an intense perplexity. And how could I blame him? I had tried to push a dozen different ideals onto him at once. filled myself with the vain hope that he would somehow be able to make sense of me when I couldn't even make sense of myself. And now, bubbling with unwarranted anger at being let down, I fled to my own chambers. I can only imagine how frustrating that must have been for him. It was the spring of my 14th year. Heavy clouds filled the sky, blocking out the sun and giving the impression of late evening all throughout the day. I, for one, preferred it when the sun wasn't out. Not that sunlight would kill me, but if it was bright enough, the whole world was so white I could hardly see a thing. Which meant I could only go outside on days when the weather made most everyone else gloomy. I mean, I live in the greater Seattle area by choice, so I can definitely empathize with her here, or him. As I was meandering through the courtyard, I spotted someone I had never seen before. A warm breeze blew past, sending up a swirl of flower petals. The girl's dress hung lightly over her frame, tracing her gentle curves. Oh, is this, George's fiancé? Who are you? I asked bluntly, and the girl twirled around, smiling. My apologies. You just have such a beautiful courtyard here, I let myself in for a little walk. Long chestnut hair flowed over round, feminine shoulders. It swayed slightly in the wind. A cloud of melancholy dissipated in the light of her smile. You must be Michelle. You're just as pretty as I heard. And you are? My name is Amy. It's a pleasure to finally meet you. Finally meet me? What was she talking about? As I stood there, baffled by this strange woman, she stepped toward me, kissing me softly on the cheek. I'm thrilled to make your acquaintance, Michelle. Her voice was like someone pouring honey into my ear, electrifyingly sweet. I'm George's fiancé. And it also stuck another needle into my chest. She was a noble girl by the name of Amy Jobert. Though only 15, she was the very image of refined, polished to a shine. No one had told me my brother was to be married. It came out of nowhere, and it seemed I was the only one who didn't know. That evening, when the family gathered around the table for supper, Amy was there too. And they prepared an extravagant feast for the occasion. My father Antonin looked so proud of his two boys. Didier is soon to receive his assignment, and George is soon to be wed. The banquet proceeded smoothly. Not a doubt in the air that we were a happy family. But my mind was elsewhere. I found myself unconsciously chasing Amy with my eyes, watching the way those slender fingers gripped her spoon, her full lips parting to allow a piece of fruit in, her deep red tongue visible but for the briefest of moments, the way all the muscles in her face seemed to relax in bliss as sweet juices seeped into her mouth, the way she spoke, so soft and gentle, letting each sound hang in the air just briefly before intoning the next. She was distinctly feminine, in a different way than my mother. Apparently, Amy was going to be living at the Bollinger estate for some time. Mother was pleased to have another girl around. Or, more specifically, she was relieved to have found someone other than my brothers for me to spend time with. I had assumed I would hate being around another girl. Surely she wouldn't be able to play chess after all. But for some reason, I felt much less suffocated around her than my mother. I like how that's the criteria for how well we can get along with people. Like, do they know how to play chess? Yes, no. One night, Amy's family and an array of nobles from both houses' social circles had assembled at the estate for a party. A din the likes of which I had never heard in my life filled the great hall. Everywhere I looked, there were people, people, people. Servants scrambled every which way. Silverware clanged against dishes in an almost constant hum. Voices from all directions. I felt moderately ill. Hey, Dee, I feel like we're critically short on waiters. This doesn't look good for us. And who was it who went about inviting everyone he came across again? Who are those people? They're artists like me. I met them at the court. Let's see, we have some painters, composers, sculptors, troubadours, poets, writers, you name it. None of them have any connection to the Joberts or Bollingers. Sure they do, they're my friends. And you know, this is me and Amy's party. You can play with your friends elsewhere. I hope you realize we have a name to uphold. Off in the corner, several men, presumably George's friends, gathered in a circle. They stood out from the other aristocrats, both in appearance and the air they gave off. The clothes they wore, the embroidery hidden beneath their jacket cuffs, their manner of speech, the way they held themselves. They were, simply put, a far cry from the hard-headed Didier's ideal party guests. Even watching them from afar, it was clear my two brothers ran in very different crowds. The only reason headstrong Didier and free-spirited Georges were able to get along at all was because they were brothers. If they'd been strangers, I doubt their paths would cross much, and if they did, those intersections would be quite rocky. Hey, come here, guys! George's shouting voice pulled my preoccupied mind back to the surface. He summoned his friends, then led them to where I stood. What are you doing hiding in the corner, Michelle? I didn't even notice you. Allow me to introduce you to a few of my friends. Oh, no. George has put his hand on my shoulders, peeling me off the wall and standing me in front of his male friends. Socialization was the last thing on my mind. I searched for Didier, hoping he would come to my rescue, but he was off trading pleasantries, facing away from me. This is my baby sister Michelle. Be nice. George's, I don't... Grace's, your skin is even more pale than I imagined. It's like something out of a fairy tale. And why have you never brought her with you to the court? She'd be a sure hit. How old are you now? 12, mayhap? Now, don't treat the lady like a child. I'll have you know she's 14. All the more reason she should be out there making friends. The whole court would flip if they knew you had such a gorgeous sister, George's. Don't be a brute, my man. Our little angel has to be kept inside for personal reasons. Uh-oh, sounds like I haven't been showing the lady her due respect. I've yet to even properly introduce myself. How rude indeed. Their laughs grated on my nerves. And so did the way George spoke as though I was his property. They looked like they were appraising me, which made me sick to my stomach. I had been paying enough attention to notice the man who had asked if I was 12, and the rest of them too, examining me from head to toe in search of curves. I was, indeed, underdeveloped for 14. But what did that matter? I didn't want a body shaped like Amy's or my mother's. Now then, m'lady, a proper greeting. The man got down on one knee before me. For a split second, I didn't comprehend what he was doing. Go on, Michelle. He's waiting. He whispered into my ear. That was when it all came back to me, the traditional greeting performed between a man and a woman. Come on, Michelle, don't tell me you forgot what to do. I knew. I knew the process. I had that knowledge. Mother had taught me the rules, shown me the procedure. I was to present my hand to the man, to kiss. All I had to do was hold out my hand, but I was frozen. My body fought tooth and nail against the simple act. The thought of that man putting his lips on my skin sent a chill through me. Why? Why was this a traditional greeting? Why did I have to go through all this? Michelle! The sound of George's frantic voice. My arm creaked up from my side. Then, I remembered that despite being his friends, they were still nobility. As wanton as social interactions may have been, he still had a reputation to maintain. And I understood that. I also understood that, as their sister, it was my responsibility not to do anything that might tarnish either of my brother's names. Also, by tradition, the man wasn't supposed to actually kiss the woman's hand. The proper way to do it required he simply mimic the act, rather than make real contact. That much I could handle. The man kneeling before me gave an uncomfortable chuckle at my reluctance, shrugged, and reverently took my hand in his. And then... he pressed his lips firmly against my skin. There was a vaguely warm sensation on the back of my hand for the briefest moment. What do you... Reflexively, I slapped the man's hand away. George's eyes went wide in horror, and the man gave another playful shrug. I was merely offering you a greeting, my lady. Or is even that a new experience to you? Your innocence is truly precious. I mean, at least he's taking it well. I was half a second away from throwing a barrage of insults, but I bit my tongue and stomped off instead. But Michelle! Hey, come back, Michelle! I spent all that time convincing myself I couldn't humiliate my brothers. Now, I wouldn't hear a word of it. I'd drawn a fair bit of attention, and other people tried to stop me too, but I brushed them all off, marching my way out of the Great Hall. I feel so dirty. Called that a greeting? No, that was no greeting. That was... I'll be taking that. I say, practically swiping a glass of water off a passing waiter's tray. With it, I washed my hand by the window facing the courtyard. But no matter how much water I poured over it, I couldn't erase the sickening sensation of his mouth on my hand. So I rubbed it with my sleeves until my skin was bright red. I wanted to feel something else. Anything else. Even pain. Think before you act, Georges. What were you doing inviting people like that into our home? I was angry, and I had every right to be. He had not performed the proper greeting. Even in jest, he had no business actually putting his lips on my hand. It was not acceptable behavior for an aristocrat. He was a guest. He should have been ashamed. Was I angry that he had been disrespectful? No, that wasn't the reason. It was... wasn't very nice of you running off like that. Ooh! Remember that, like, creepy romantic line I was going on about earlier in the Let's Play? We are dangerously close to passing it. And actually, never mind. We passed it a while ago. At the sound of his voice, I couldn't turn back. I felt a sickening warmth almost directly against my back. Yep, definitely in the creepy range. The man from the Great Hall grabbed me by my wrists, spun me around, and pressed me against the wall. The bitter scent of wine wafted from above. What the hell are you doing? I tried a second time to get away from him, and that was when reality sunk in. I couldn't do it. All the strength I could muster wasn't enough to make the man's hand budge. My arms were locked in place. I didn't think he was especially strong, either. He was hardly built like Didier. And still, I couldn't move an inch. You've got a tongue like a boy, m'lady. But I do know some people who are fond of that these days. Can't say I mind myself. Let go! Had I always been this feeble? Were my arms truly so worthless I couldn't even escape this brute's grip? Why did I have to get stuck with this body? Now, just so we're clear, I'm not gonna hurt you. I'm no monster, I promise you that. Then why are you holding me against this wall? Because I want a chance to try and woo you. You and I clearly have very different definitions of that word. I apologize if I made you uncomfortable back there, but the second I laid eyes on you, I knew you were a keeper. Then let go of me. But if I do that, you'll run away. Yeah, she will. This is like a problem I have with transgender people. Not like problem, but like complication. Is like when referring to them before they come out, which pronoun are you supposed to use? I recognize that this is like super trivial. Or at least like from the perspective of me having difficulty with it. Like from my end, it's super trivial, so I shouldn't like complain. But it just is like kind of awkward. Anyhow, awkward aside. And it's my personal rule to never let go of anything I like. Yeah, you're definitely creepy as hell, dude. Your brother says you can't go outside, so if I set you loose now, I might never get a chance to catch you again. I wanted to vomit. Yeah, me too. Apparently, taking my silence for approval, the man perked up and kept going. If you're not accustomed to being around men, then why not use this as an opportunity to get familiar? Not a half bad idea if I do say so myself. And I think we'd get along quite well. Really, now. Besides, I'm a minstrel. Spend some time with me, and I'll write you all the songs you could possibly want. Get away from me. You really do have the most striking eyes. Makes me want to keep them all for myself. Yeah, that's definitely creepy. If I'm amused like that, I could write the most incredible songs you've ever heard. I said get back, you creep. Huh, that's odd. That one's never failed me. The man brought his face in just inches from mine and peered into my eyes. I could feel his hot, wine-stench breath against my cheeks. He gave me the chills. I couldn't understand why this was happening to me. Panic and confusion had my heart racing. Go try your luck with someone else. I'm not interested. You will be soon enough, darling. You've simply never known a man's touch. Yeah, okay, so, like, we're well past the line. Like, we're far off in the distance that we can't even see the line if we, like, look back over our shoulders. He drew closer. He was already practically on top of me, but still he closed in. Closer and closer. The world faded out. I couldn't see anything. I could feel his rising body heat so near it made me nauseous. My eyes flung open. There was nothing there. I could only feel. I couldn't move. My body wouldn't budge. In my mind, I kicked the man away. Pulled my fist back and slammed it into his jaw. Again and again and again until his face was unrecognizable. Again and again and again and again I beat him. But reality would have none of that. Michelle! Hey, what do you think you're doing? 3 seconds? 10 seconds? Longer? I had no idea how much time I had lost. But the next thing I knew, Georges had the man by the collar. I fell back against the wall, staring absentmindedly as the two struggled. They traded blows and they traded insults. Before long, they had drawn a crowd. While they went at it, I distractedly drifted away, and I only had one place to go. I didn't even bother to light a candle. I just stared into the darkness. My heartbeat was maddeningly loud in my otherwise silent chambers. What had happened? What had he done to me? Why couldn't I do anything? The last thing I wanted to do was cry. Tears would only serve to worsen my humiliation. Only magnify how wretched I was. Only make me more effete. That's a word I did not know. Still don't know, actually. E-F-F-E-T-E. I'm gonna look that up later. E-F-F-E-T-E. I bit down on my lip hard. I had no need for that trash in my body. I dug my nails into my arms. I had no need for that trash in my body. All this. Every last bit of it. That was why I was the way I was. I didn't know how to put it into words. I didn't know how to express this boundless frustration within me. But after enough wordless groaning, a single word slipped from my lips, and it felt incredibly right. God damn it! I knew good and well a girl should not be using such words. Even Didier and Georges would have gotten an earful from mother or father if they were caught saying it. Regardless, God damn it! It was the most fitting word I could come up with to represent even the smallest bit of my anger and loathing. I knew all I was doing was shifting the blame. That all it would accomplish was making me look pitiful. But I would take that over crying like a girl any day. I let loose a sigh that was halfway to being a scream, then started clawing wildly at my hair. I wanted to yank out every last damn strand of it. I didn't want it. I didn't want any of it. Any of this body. But in that case, what did I want from my body? Michelle? May I come in, Michelle? It was George's voice, slightly muffled through the door. The man who had invited those people into this house. I would be lying if I said I didn't hold that against him. Michelle. But at the same time, he'd also come to my rescue. Besides, I hated myself the most. I despised myself for being so helpless. I'm sorry, Michelle. I didn't mean to hurt you. It's not locked. After a few moments of silence, Georgia stepped into my room. Your hair's a mess, Michelle. And my God, you're bleeding. That was when I first noticed the stinging sensation in my lower lip. Metallic taste spread through my mouth. I'd been biting it much harder than I realized, and there was a lot more blood than I expected. A trail of it was running down my chin, seconds from spilling onto my clothes when George's wiped it away. I'm really sorry, Michelle. He can be a real ass when he drinks. And he's a bit of a womanizer at that. I never expected he'd try to go after you, though. I'm really sorry. I didn't mean for this to happen. But, you know, there's a chance he may have genuinely taken a liking to you. That just makes it worse. Sorry. You're right. You want to be with a man you like, I understand. He ran his hand through my hair, as if trying to calm me down, at the same time cleaning up the mess I had made of it. It made me feel like I was some kind of plaything. A joke of a doll. I don't want to be with anyone. I would never, ever be comfortable with a man putting his hands on me like that. However, I'm sure you'll find someone eventually, Michelle. Someone that feels right for you. I feel kind of awful for introducing you to him, but there are plenty of men in the world. You might not be interested now, but that'll change soon. It's part of growing up. You'd be best off forgetting today ever happened. I was dead certain, but apparently that wasn't enough to convince him. The very idea that I might one day meet a man who I wanted to touch me made my skin crawl. Why? Why did I feel like this? Was I just not interested in men? No. If that were the case, I wouldn't admire my brother's bodies. I didn't have an aversion to men. In fact, I enjoyed spending time with my brothers far more than indulging my mother and her woman's world. What I couldn't stand was a particular look men would sometimes give me. But why? Why did I not like that? I had no answer. My thoughts were only going in circles. Are you okay, Michelle? He peered down at me, his face twisted in concern. But I couldn't answer him. How was I supposed to articulate this? My anger. My frustration. My irritation. My fear. That I had no confidence he would understand. George's? How's Michelle? Amy's voice came from the doorway. Inexplicably, I felt like someone had stuck their hand in my chest and was now squeezing my heart. Like I had just been caught in a compromising situation by the last person I wanted to see me. Yeah, she's doing good. Aren't you? Yes, I'm fine. Glad to hear it. I was clearly lying, not even looking him in the eyes when I said that, but that seemed to have gone over George's head. Amy, on the other hand. You don't look fine at all, she said, a hint of pain in her voice, and then entered the room. George's father was asking for you. He says it's time to bring the gathering to a close. You should get going. I'll stay here with her. Oh, is he? All right, then. Sounds good. George's is a bit of a dunce, isn't he? Once the sound of George's footsteps had faded into nothing, Amy took a seat behind me, and without warning, wrapped her arms around my shoulders. It's much better to talk to another girl at times like these. My heart leapt into my throat, and beyond the shock, I also found myself welcoming the warmth. It was pleasant, unlike the man's. That must have been terrifying. But don't worry, you're safe now. It wasn't really, no. You need to pretend, sweetie. If a man had pinned me against a wall, I'd be scared too. I meant it. I wasn't scared. I'm just disappointed in myself. All right, I believe you. You're a strong girl, Michelle. There aren't many who wouldn't have been scared. I'll be sure to give George a stern talking to about his choice in friends. Yeah, you do that. Something I learned today is he's somewhat of a pushover. You're a lot more tenacious than I thought. As a woman in this world, you have to be. And if you're not, well, you'll figure it out soon enough, Michelle. Of course, even as strong as you are, I'm sure it'll still be difficult to forget what happened to you today. George has told me to forget it as soon as possible, and Amy that I wouldn't be able to. Was it the difference in their individual perspectives, or was it the difference between the way men and women thought? I wasn't sure. As my head rested against her breast, a bit of my frustration slipped out. I couldn't move my arms at all. I didn't even seem all that strong. I couldn't believe that I was really so weak. That's just the way of the world, Michelle. Men are physically stronger than women. You'll almost never overpower one. You're not any weaker than a normal girl. Don't blame yourself. But it wasn't the consolation I'd hoped for. Her words still filled me with warmth. I'd exploited my own weakness to hear more of that soothing voice. And I alone knew how foolish I was in doing so. Amy frequently visited my chambers. I didn't know if it was at Mother's request or of her own volition, but I prayed it was the latter. She was a very touchy-feely person, and she seemed to have a particular fondness for playing with my hair. Whenever her voice danced its way into my ears, it would wreak havoc with inside me. Being enveloped in her scent day after day stoked the fire growing within me. I did my best to remain as straight-faced as possible, because the last thing I wanted was her catching on. I understood that the things I was feeling were untoward, to say the least. Your hair is so utterly enchanting. I've never seen hair so white before. I think having color is much prettier. Oh? Well, Georgia says white is the most difficult color to make with paint. There's no greater challenge than capturing the beauty of true white. Living with such a splendid example of the color must have given him a very high standard. Living with such a splendid example of the color must have given him a very high standard of quality. Say, Michelle, maybe you could tell me about yourself today. I would love to get to know you better. Tell you about myself? Yeah, we could become even better friends if we found some mutual interests. I enjoy playing chess, and I consider myself quite good. Oh my, chess? I've never played. You're such a bright girl, Michelle. Oh, Amy doesn't know how to play chess. Out with her. She is unqualified as a friend. Would you like to try? I could teach you. I appreciate the offer, but I think I'll pass. Yep, definitely out with this one. Hard no. Swipe, I don't use Twinders. Swiping left or right, no. Left, maybe? I'm like at least 50-50 to get it right, right? I doubt it would be any good. Oh, okay. What else is there? Say, your favorite kind of flower, fragrance, color of gemstone? Are there any embroidery patterns you're particularly skilled at? I don't have any favorites, no. And I'm not especially good with a needle, either. No? You have shaky hands, then? I wouldn't say that, no. I'm fairly good with a knife, I think. A knife? Oh, like a kitchen knife? No, a sculpting knife. Sculpting? Is that really so strange? It is a bit unusual, I'd say. But George's does it all the time. His room is practically made of wood chips and charcoal and paint. George's is an artist, and a man. There's nothing unusual about him doing some sculpting. Why is it okay for him, but not me? Does being a girl really make that much of a difference? Well, why don't we practice embroidery together, Michelle? I get the feeling you spent too much time with your brothers. But now you have me. I'm sure it won't be long before you appreciate how much fun cooking and needlework can be. She sounds just like Mother. And she gives the same reason, too. Because I'm a girl. But that's not an explanation. It's a vague generalization. That said, if I agree, you can spend more time with her. You're a dumbass, Michael. But you're a relatable dumbass. Okay. Wonderful. We'll come up with beautiful designs together. And when you've made something you're proud of, you can give it to a boy who catches your eye. Or, if you'd prefer, you could give it to your father or brother. I would like George's to have what I make, though. Oh, I've been wondering. Did you and George's meet at the royal court? Oh, heavens no. I've never been to the court. One day, my father told me I was getting married. And the next day is when we first met. It happened that quickly? What, are you worried about me, Michelle? Don't worry, I'm not displeased with the arrangement. In fact, I'm quite happy with it. Aristocratic marriages are almost always sudden. And as a woman, you get used to being a piece in their games. But George's, he's different. He's a gentleman. A gentleman? Him? You sound surprised. I believe hedonist suits him better. Oh, I quite disagree. I have complete faith he'll do good by me. I couldn't fathom where she found such confidence in him. Especially a man she'd only just met. How could she trust him at all? He was nothing but a pawn, and she knew it. So maybe she was just putting on an act. I had trouble believing her smile was anything but genuine, though. One day, you'll meet the right man for you, Michelle. And he won't be drunk like the guy from earlier. He'll be a kind, hard-working, respectable man. I would rather not find anyone. I suppose this is all still too soon for you, huh? Say, how old are you, Michelle? 14. Oh, wow, I assumed you were younger. Do I really look that young? No hard feelings. You're just like a tiny little doll, so small and slender. And look, not one bit of meat up here at all. Hey! She playfully grabbed me from behind, and started prodding at my chest. As her delicate fingers slid across my skin, I found myself gripped by very indecent urges. Every heavy thump of my heart felt sinful. She couldn't know. I couldn't let her. Everything I'd been fighting to keep down came hurtling to the surface. You're so cold, you know that? She was touching me like it was nothing. caressing my hair. Was she this intimate with George's? Or was it because I was a younger girl that she was so keen on putting her hands all over me? Before I understood what I was feeling, my body acted. It was pure, unfiltered impulse. My attempt to escape from her grip, I twisted around, only to find my face inches from Amy's. Slowly gravitating closer, I pressed my lips against the corner of her mouth. Amy sat there, flabbergasted. Yeah, don't make out with your brother's fiancé. That's, I think a faux pas. I was equally aghast. I'm sorry. As I frantically put some distance between us, I'm sure my face was red as an apple, though I didn't know it at the time. Well, that was certainly unexpected. I'm sorry, did I make you uncomfortable touching you so much? Amy was smiling, though it looked forced. No, not at all. Then I must have startled you. I'm sorry, if I'd let you go sooner, we could have avoided this accident. What do you mean, accident? A kiss on the lips is... It wasn't an accident. She was giving you an out there, Michael. You could at least play to it. It wasn't, Amy. I seem to have confused you somewhat, Michelle. What? I know I can be very touchy-feely with you. And you took that to mean you should do the same. No. You can't do that again, alright? If you want to kiss your friends, you do it on the cheek. Save the lips for the man you love. I should get going, then. George starts getting cranky if I don't give him enough attention. Hold on, Amy. So long, Michelle. She wouldn't hear me out. Once Amy had fled my chambers, that was when I finally comprehended my own emotions, that she had stolen my heart. But Amy was George's fiancée. No, that wasn't the problem. I would argue that that's the problem. But then again, I come from a millennia later in terms of, you know, social norms. My body was not meant for her love. I woke in the middle of the night with pain in my joints. Not enough exercise, I guess. I tried bending and stretching my arms and legs, but it did nothing. After pondering on it for a bit, I decided to go for a late night walk to distract myself. As I approached the corridor adjacent to the courtyard, I heard a woman's voice. I'm still concerned about staying here. Amy's voice. Doing my best to remain perfectly quiet, I pressed myself up against the wall by the window and listened in on their conversation. I knew it was improper to eavesdrop, but the sound of her voice had me frozen in place. It's Michelle. I'm afraid I've confused her. A tiny jolt ran down my spine, my muscles all tensing up at once. The sound of my name rising to her lips, but not in the way I would have liked. She kissed me. Well, almost, but... How could I have guessed she thought of me that way? Mother told me she didn't have any female friends, and asked me to be one for her, which is why... So she had only been coming to see me because Mother had asked her to. I'd been afraid of that. Afraid that she wasn't there to be with me. That she had no fondness for me. My yearning for her was one-sided. She kind of scares me, the way she looks at me. Always watching every little move I make. I'm sensitive to that kind of thing. I can tell what's going through Michelle's mind. I managed to deflect it this time, but... I should never have gotten friendly with her. She had seen me... She'd seen through me from day one. Understood what I was feeling before even I had. It's disgusting, homosexuality. Homosexuality? Did I hear her right? Something inside me crumbled. And with it came an intense sense of wrongness. There it was again. An overpowering discomfort. That fear coursing through my veins. That repulsion. That irritation. That apprehension. What on earth was I? Did I view Amy as a member of the same sex? Were the things I felt homosexual? I heard Amy sigh from beyond the window. Then, the man beside her, who she was confiding all this in, replied, "She's still just a child." That voice. And one with underdeveloped social skills, besides. Understand that she's going to do and say some inappropriate things. It's not uncommon for a child to mistake admiration for love. And I didn't know this until recently, but when she gets something into her head, she has a tendency to run with it without thinking. It was not the man's I'd assumed it was. Oh, it's Didier? The other day, she asked me to let her be a knight. I can't imagine how she thought that would end any other way. Why? It's not very often there are women other than Mother at the estate. I imagine she simply got nervous being around you and something got mixed up in her head. Why was Didier out there with her? I hope that's all it was. Amy, hadn't you told me you thought George's was a gentleman? So what were you doing getting so friendly with Didier? And Didier, weren't you my ally? Or is that all an act, like her? You're going to be a knight. So why were you out here with your brother's fiancé? So wait, literally all three of the siblings fell in love with the same chick? That's, awkward beyond belief. I'm glad to have you here, so I hope you can figure something out to make it work. I'll do what I can, but... And I'm kind of reluctant to say this to you, but something has to change. As it is, she kind of grosses me out. She grosses me out. So what, I was some kind of sick, disgusting creature? All I'd done was show feelings for her. I couldn't be George's or Didier. The needles piercing me expanded, both in size and number. Soon, I was being skewered by a dozen of them. As the heated sighs rising from the courtyard only served to make the pain worse. All I could do was cover my ears and run.
Why? What were you doing out there, Didier?
How am I gross, Amy?
It's not real.
It's all a bunch of lies. The entire house is nothing but a fraud. None of it was ever real. The family's gatherings, Amy's smiles, Didier's kindness, George's. What about George's? Did he agree to the marriage knowing about them? What the hell are they thinking? I want to know who's really disgusting.
God damn it.
I will not cry. I will not cry. I can't let myself. Girls cry. Tears are for girls, not for me. I bit down hard on my lip, wrapped myself in my sheets, and pressed my hands hard over my ears, squeezing my eyes as tight as I could imagine, as I could manage. Tried to get away from the things I had seen. Images of them embracing in the night threatened to float back to the surface, but I shook my head, casting them off. Praying I wouldn't have any nightmares, I drifted off to sleep. Next day, I awoke with a terrible fever. I hovered in a sweltering wave of heat, unable to tell dream and reality apart, listening to a seemingly endless stream of cracking noises. The sounds were coming from inside my body. I thought I was falling apart. Mother was horribly worried. I'd never been the most healthy child, but I'd never fallen this ill either. I couldn't get out of bed. My voice was raspy, like an old woman's. I was genuinely afraid I would wither away and die. Mother called in doctor after doctor to see me, but they all said it was the flu. That bodily pain was common with a fever. While there was a doctor in the house, Mother was able to remain relatively calm, but once they were gone, the anxiety came back. She stayed with me, day and night, even foregoing sleep. Her hands gripped mine. They held me fast. She had her head bowed, as if in prayer. Don't be worried. You'll be all right, Michelle. God is watching over you. He will protect you. You are his child. You are his angel sent to Earth. He will not forsake you. The doctors say it's just the flu. Though her words seemed to be directed at me, there was a vacantness in her voice, as if they were really for herself. For so long, she had wanted a daughter. I couldn't understand her fixation, but seeing her there through my cloudy eyes, I wanted to apologize for ever thinking spending time with her was agonizing. How are you feeling? Your mother's here for you, don't worry. But the only sound that came from my mouth was a faint gasp. I drifted in and out of sleep, Mother's hand wrapped around my own. And I had numerous dreams. In my dreams, I was a man. In my dreams, I was Didier and I was George's. In my dreams, I fell in love with Amy. And in my dreams, I loved her. You're disgusting. But with one word, the dreams twisted into nightmares. My body was torn into fleshy chunks, and I sunk into the darkness. Several days later, my fever was gone, like it had never been there. However, my voice did not recover. And when I attempted to climb from my bed, the murderous pain in my joints came rushing back. Instead of my feet, I landed on my face. Weird. What is this joint pain? I, like, don't have any ideas here. My voice was unbelievably deep. And the pain only got worse. Every time I took a breath, it felt like someone hammering a spike into the back of my neck. It felt like my body was falling apart. My dreams were becoming reality. Michelle! Michelle! When Mother scrambled into my chambers, I remembered the time she had spent at my bedside, and a wave of relief came over me. I reached my hand out in a show of vulnerability, but she didn't take it. She couldn't take it. Mother! What's wrong with your voice, Michelle? I see. You're still not feeling well, are you, Michelle? A look of restrained fear on her face. Mother stepped toward me, placing her hand on my forehead. So, wait. Is Michael developing an Adam's apple? Like, what's going on here? Her palm felt hot against my skin. I don't have a fever. But I hurt all over. My joints. You're still sick, Michelle. But don't worry, you'll be fine in no time. Now, back to bed with you. You're a girl. You're a girl, so you shouldn't be sitting on the floor. It's bad for your back. As Mother repeated the phrase, you're a girl, again and again, the nagging sense that something wasn't quite right grew more distinct. Was I really sick? Was this actually my voice now? And if it was, what was I turning into? My voice was certainly not a girl's voice. Like, biologically, what's going on here? I'm super confused. My voice never went back to normal, though, so Mother ordered me to remain in my room. I hadn't recovered yet. And so long as I was sick, I couldn't be let out. Again, something felt wrong with her calling it a sickness, but I had no evidence to the contrary. I had no way to know I wouldn't get others sick if I exposed them, as she claimed, so I had no choice but to do as she said. In time, Mother too stopped visiting me, and the only people I saw were servants. They did their jobs, but refused to look me in the eye. No one else came to see me, though. Not Amy, Didier, or George's. 1 month passed, then two, then three. Occasionally, the pain in my joints would withdraw. At other times, it would worsen. Whenever I would drift off to sleep, I would hear the sound of my own joints creaking. I would dream of a woman standing in the courtyard, her soft chestnut hair fluttering in the wind as she twirled to face me, a smile on her face and her breasts exposed. One day, after around 6 months of servants refusing to make eye contact, I stopped one and made a request to have a mirror brought to my room. While he didn't acknowledge me, the next day I had my mirror. By that point, I was fairly sure I knew what was happening to my body. I had no clothes to wear, because none of the multicolored dresses hanging in my wardrobe fit me anymore. Pulling the heavy red cloth and covering the mirror aside, my completely naked body came into view. Something resembling a mix of a chuckle and a sigh of pity spilled from my lips. This is me? 6 months. After only 6 months' time, I could hardly recognize myself. Okay, so I was wrong in my earlier assessment that what Michael has is just gender dysphoria. There's also something biological going on here. Extending my hand for the mirror, I traced the outline of my bony reflection. My shoulders lacked Mother's curves, and my skin Amy's sheen. I was pale and haggard, but structurally, I looked like my brothers. Obviously, being younger than them and not as active, my muscles lacked any kind of strength, but I wouldn't have batted an eye if I saw myself holding a sword. I was a full head taller than I'd been 6 months earlier, and I felt a certain oddity that I wasn't done growing either. Staring at myself in the mirror, I traced my name across the surface. Michelle. Don't need the last two. Michael. For the first time in my life, I liked my name. Oh, okay. Now I understand what the weird spacing is. Like, I was confused there. I was, like, wondering, is there, like, some significance there? But that's because that was originally in English. And so they didn't have to translate that. So that line is probably a direct translation. It's not some weird thing with the katakana. Which makes sense, given that it's set in, Europe, I guess. Probably. For the first time in my life, I liked my name. I didn't think an angel's name suited me one bit. But it was staggering how different it felt now, even if it sounded exactly the same. Those last two letters changed the meaning entirely, turning it from a girl's name to a boy's name. Now this makes sense. Everything was falling into place. My admiration for Didier, the envy I had had for my brother's bodies, the feelings I had for Amy, the indecent dreams I'd been having. I was always male. I cackled like a fool for the first time in my life. I laughed so hard at the sight of myself, my stomach hurt. It was the first glimmer of light I had seen in his locker room for far too long. This is what I was supposed to look like. My life up until 6 months ago, constricted and uncomfortable. My life as a girl was all a lie. No one could possibly look at me and call me an angel. I was always a boy, but I had been told I was a girl, forced to act like one. Of course it wouldn't feel right. They needed to know. I couldn't be the only one who understood. Everyone in this house needed to. Ha! Ah! Fueled by this one desire, I wrapped a sheet over my shoulders and threw open my door. It seemed ridiculous how long I had followed Mother's instructions and remained cooped up in my room. And now, I felt fantastic. If there was truly a god in heaven, and this change within me was his answer to my prayers. A manservant carrying a tray of food did a double take as I passed him. The farther I proceeded through the corridors, the more eyes I felt on me. The midday sun showed obnoxiously bright through the windows. But now, with its piercing radiation illuminating my proper self, I felt an odd affection for the light. So is this like Morgana's doing? Because I'd assumed that because she was like killed in the top of the observation tower, her powers were more sort of geographically linked than anything else. But it's possible that Morgana, like, so Morgana's modus operandi for a good chunk of the story, as I see it, is she needed essentially a maid to like physically do stuff in the house while she was torturing people, right? Like that was the motive that that was what motivated a lot of her actions. So I guess it's possible that she like was able to do this from the mansion to make Michael indebted to her, because I'm having a little bit of trouble reconciling like what's going on right now with like real life phenomena. Like, if Michael had been biologically male from day one, then there's no reason for the parents to, like, mistake him for a girl, right? Like, presumably when he was born, they saw him naked, right? They would have seen that the parts downstairs were different. So, there's clearly some sort of change going on here, and I can't think of any, like, real-world phenomenon that would cause that change. And so far, the only, like, magical thing in the series, as best I can tell, is Morgana. But it's surprising me, it's kind of surprising because I thought that Morgana's powers were tied to the mansion. But now, with its piercing radiation illuminating my proper self, I felt an odd affection for the light. Aren't you still, like, allergic to light, though? I could hear the family gathered in the Great Hall, everyone but me. Didier's voice complained about the simple meals the church provided, but his pride came through in his laughter. George's voice playfully bragged about his life at the royal court. Father's voice informed everyone his investments had borne fruit, and with the money, he'd purchased several new estates. Oh, and this is the part where Antonin tries to kill Michael, probably. Mother's voice was distinctly less bright than the rest of the family's. She gave vague, empty indications she was listening, that mostly stayed out of the conversation. Amy's voice sang her praises for George's, her beloved husband. Never mind the fact she was sleeping with Didier. It was all a facade, a mere shadow of a family. It's a shame Michelle couldn't be here. Then you would have everyone. I was there. I was right there. I hadn't gone anywhere. You just locked me in my room. I hope she recovers soon. I was never sick at all. The child you called Michelle was actually your son. That was all there was to it. Huh? Hmm? What? Everyone's gazes were concentrated on me. I gave them all a quick glance, and then, with my deepened voice, I said, I'm cured. I was cured 6 months ago. Who are you? Surely you haven't forgotten my face, have you? Father. Michelle? Michelle? This boy is Michelle? A wave of chatter spread through the hall. Mother went pale. Father objected. Didier stared. George gaped. Amy watched cautiously, fear in her eyes. What a farce. They were the ones who had wrongly decided I was a girl. What's going on? Someone tell me, what is the meaning of this? You're dressing your son up like a girl, Mother? I assumed he was a girl. Otherwise, I wouldn't have put my hands all over him like that. You lied to me. I would never have agreed to it had I known. No, you're wrong. Michelle is my daughter. You called that a girl? All these months, I was worried because you said he was sick. That was all a lie? You couldn't pass him off as a girl anymore, so you locked him up in his room? Is that what this is? And you could have just stayed there. What possessed you to show yourself now? Stop that. Don't look at me. Don't give me that look. You said you can tell what's going through my mind, didn't you? What? And you should know exactly how I feel about you right now. Don't be so damn full of yourself. I have no interest in a whore like you. So why don't you go cry into Didier's arms? Okay, so you're, like, springing a pretty big surprise on your family, right? Like, coming out with hostility right out of the gate might not be the best strategy here. Like, I don't blame you, but I argue with your choice of tactic. You. What? What? Huh? What are you talking about? Why Didier? Why not me? What? Hey, anyone want to explain that for me? What had once been a nice family meal was now utter chaos. Good job, Michael. You done fucked it up. For the briefest moment, I felt sorry for George's, but that whisked away almost immediately. There was a crash from the table, and dishes fell, shattering against the floor. Cursed. A chilling darkness oozed from her voice. She's cursed. She was my daughter. I saw it with my own eyes. I gave birth to her. She was a girl. Michelle was a girl. A malevolent curse has been placed on her. I mean, you can call it a curse, but, like, it's not malevolent, right? It's benevolent. When Mother lifted her head, I had difficulty believing that was the same woman who had sat by my bedside as I lay sick, sacrificing sleep to care for me. Her hair was a frazzled mess, and deep creases covered her face. Restrain her! Throw her in her room and lock the door! She's a girl! A girl! She was a girl, I swear it! Open your eyes! Do I sound like a girl? Do I look anything like a girl? Mother's cries sent me into a frenzy. I ripped the sheet out off my shoulders, throwing it to the floor. I am not a girl! And shouted.
Restrain her! Please, someone restrain her!
Fear reigned in the great hall. But then, several moments of icy silence were broke by a muttering that shocked me as much as anyone else.
You're not a boy or a girl. What on earth are you?
You're an abomination. You're not a boy. You're an abomination. I'm... what? I'd seen myself in the mirror. I was undoubtedly male. Lacking in strength, though they may have been, I had visible muscles. My chest was flat, and I was taller than a girl should be. My voice was deep, and I had an obvious lump in the middle of my throat. I was male. I had to be male. What else could I be? So why was Amy looking at me like some kind of strange creature? A chill ran down my spine, and I suddenly found myself deeply uncomfortable being so exposed.
There's nothing there. You've got nothing there.
Nothing there? Oh, that's what you're gonna get hung up on? Rude. I didn't understand what she was talking about. Unable to press further, I fell silent, at which point several servants burst into the great hall and restrained me.
She's a girl. She's my daughter.
Mother, seemingly in a mad daze, just repeated the same thing over and over.
She was a girl!
As Mother wailed, she wandered off somewhere. Father stood there in silence. Amy stared at me with disgust in her eyes. George's was still in a panic, and Didier clenched his fists. Eventually, I started regaining my composure, which is when I realized I had made a mistake. My sickness had been made into a curse. Oops. I was, once more, caged up in my room. In addition to the door being locked from the outside, the windows were boarded over so no one could see in, leaving me in perpetual darkness. Okay, so I guess the dad is not trying to kill him right now. I guess that comes later. Alright, let me grab some water real quick.
Okay, that was perhaps a little bit aggressive. There's no water in my nose. We made a mistake.
Now, normally you would ask, so Teo, why are you putting water in your nose? And I wouldn't really have a good answer for you. Because, like, I recognize on an intellectual level that normally the water is supposed to go in my mouth. But somehow I decided that today would be different. Well, decided is perhaps a strong word. But I received no visitors except the servants. And again, none of them would look me in the eye. Every day was the same. Day in and day out, day in and day out. The only time the routine changed was when, on occasion, a servant would arrive bearing a letter. It was my mother's handwriting on the parchment. We lived in the same house, yet she refused to show herself before me. Oh, here's another question. When does the painter show up? I had no choice but to respond to her letters. She demanded I speak like a girl, and I didn't have the strength to defy her. There was a constant sense of urgency to her letters, like she might fall apart completely at any second. And so I did as she said. Yeah, I guess that part doesn't translate quite as well. Because, like, obviously, or maybe not obviously, if you're not familiar. If you're not familiar with Japanese, Japanese has a wide swath of words and phrases that are pretty gender-coded. Like, I don't know, kashira, for example, is a sentence qualifier that is pretty exclusively feminine. Like, if you say that and you're a guy, you'll sound really weird. So, presumably, the dialogue here makes more sense in the original. And so I did as she said. I signed each letter Michelle, the female name she bestowed upon me at birth, which I so despised. Every time I used that name, I felt like I was denying my own identity. On paper, she expressed her concern for me, but that concern only served to cause me more pain. So every time I took up the quill, my hands trembled. Mother, prayed daily that my curse might one day be broken. Am I cursed? Is that why my body changed? Was it not because I was male? There's nothing there. What did she mean by that? Why did she look at me the way she did? How am I an abomination? Okay, so this is where we get an anatomy textbook, Michael. Why? I
don't understand. Someone, anyone, please tell me. Someone, please!
Is Morgana gonna show up? That would be unfortunate. I've brought you supper. Okay. No Morgana yet. I will be back shortly to retrieve your dishes. I'll be going then. Wait. What? Wait a minute. Yes? What do you need, Michelle? Are you a man or a woman? Pardon? Which are you? I am exactly what I appear to be. Which are you? I am a man. If that is all, I will be going now. Close. Off.
Surely there are better ways of going about this, Michael. Maybe not.
What? Take your clothes off. Right now. Everything. Even your underclothes. Surely you jest, Michelle. I am very serious. I could not possibly... Why not? I could not expose myself. I ordered you to take off your clothes. You mean to humiliate me? I beg you, please reconsider.
What are you? You're a servant of the Bollinger Estate. And what am I? I am a child of the Bollinger family. I may be locked up, imprisoned in this room, but that doesn't make you any less my servant. Am I wrong?
Man, you gotta feel a little bit bad for the servant here, right? Like, you just thought you were bringing dinner to the child of the house, locked up in her bedroom, his bedroom, whatever pronoun servant wants to use. And then all of a sudden you get ordered to strip. I feel like that's not under the list of standard servantly duties. Clothes off.
Michelle, I order you to take your clothes off.
Not even the tiniest sliver of guilt arose in my conscience. I felt no shame in what I was doing. All that mattered to me was figuring out what Amy had meant. I wanted to find the truth, not knowing I would have been better off in the dark. His face twisted in humiliation, the servant undressed before me. In the dim candlelight, the man's body was shaped almost like a rectangle. At a glance, it didn't appear much different than me. A second later, though, I found my answer. I found the one crucial thing he had that I didn't. Why? My lower body lacked the part that made a man a man.
Are you satisfied, Michelle?
That was when I finally learned what a man's body was supposed to look like.
I'm begging you, please allow me to dress. It would be an unbearable shame to remain unclothed any longer. Before the young Bollinger daughter.
Daughter? You still insist on calling me a damn girl? Look at these shoulders, my chest, listen to my voice. How can you possibly think any of that belongs to a girl?
But how you appear does not...
There is a distinct look of fear in the manservant's eyes. Not out of respect for our difference in rank, but out of disgust for this incomprehensible thing standing there before him. Those trembling eyes, and the reality dangling there before me, blew the lid once more off everything I had been holding back. Without that, you'd be no different than me.
What?
Everything else. Everything else is all the same. So why? Why does it make such a difference that you have one and I don't?
Michelle?
I am a man. I'm a man, just like you. I am no one's daughter. If you still insist we're not the same, then I'll make you like me.
Okay, that's pushing it a little bit far.
Castration is not the answer, Michael.
Ah!
Without that, you're no different than me. It was a mix of dread and panic that pushed me over the edge. And so, in order to keep myself afloat, I decide to bring another pain.
Please don't do this, Michelle.
In a blind frenzy, hardly even aware of what I was doing, just riding the current of my erupting emotions, I swiped a knife off the tray the man had brought, knocked him down, and climbed onto me.
Please don't.
I'll get rid of that. I'll make you the same. Without it, you'll be just like me.
Get off me, please. Someone, help.
I'll make you just like me.
Get in here. Someone. Anyone. Michelle. She's delirious.
Through the fog of hysteria, I suddenly realized I was surrounded by several servants, and the next thing I knew, I was on the floor beneath them. There were as many, if not more of them, than when I had made the scene in the Great Hall. A dozen men servants stared down at me, their eyes filled with fear and revulsion. And in the shadows beyond the crowd, I saw Mother looking in on me with vacant eyes.
Mother, why? Why will you only speak to me through letters? Why do you say I'm cursed?
Mother, I'm male. I was always male. Tell me that I am, Mother. Let me out of here, please. I'm not delirious. My head is perfectly clear.
That's what a delirious person would say.
I'm not normal. There's nothing wrong with me.
Also, a delirious person would be threatening to cut off other people's penises. Just saying. I'm not cursed. Mother, say something. Mother! After that, I was shut in my room again, and even the servants stopped coming. I pushed and I shoved and I pulled and I pounded with all my strength, but the door and windows didn't budge. A day passed, and then another. With no food or water, I started fearing death was upon me. I had no idea how miserable it was to go so long without water. My throat was dry and cracked, and it felt like it was on fire, making breathing difficult. 2 days, 48 long hours. I felt like I was going to lose my mind. After just 2 days, my skin stretched tight across my bones, looking hard and dry in the soft candlelight. Water. I need water. Someone, please, give me water. Why won't anyone bring me any? My family had abandoned me, and were leaving me to die in this room. When I realized that, I broke into uncontrollable shaking. The helplessness threatened to suffocate me. Fear of death turned to panic, which only scrambled my already confused mind further. I grabbed a chair, swinging it at the window, at the door. But all my attempts ended in crushing failure. Anyone! I clawed at the door, begging for help. Someone! Open the door! Anyone! Water! I need water! One drop, that's all I need! Probably need more than that. I'm gonna die in here! Someone! Anyone! Mother! Father! Didier! Georges! Someone open the door, please! Help me! Someone! I need water! My throat hurts! It burns! I'm so weak! Someone! Water! Didier! Georges! Anyone! But not a single soul came to the door. With no food or water, the third day came and went, and then the fourth. By that point, I was expectedly devoid of any sense of dignity, and I sat there, covered in all manner of human filth, as my body quickly wasted away. Still, I clung to the vain hope that someone would open the door. It was all I had. Occasionally, I would hear footsteps. Whenever I did, I mustered up what meager strength I had left to bang on the door. Whoever's there, please, open the door. I'm begging you. Someone. But my pleas fell on deaf ears. Though they didn't respond to me, I could hear the Abigails muttering to one another in the chambers. In the corridor, rather. Did you hear that? Yes, I did. I wonder what's gotten into Lady Michelle. They say she was cursed. Maybe she sold her soul to the devil. How dreadful. We should stay away from that door. We don't want to be cursed too. Maybe she sold her soul to the devil. Oh, how dreadful. I am not cursed. I did not sell my soul to the devil. I'm kind of scared. I might have to find work somewhere else. Gotta make sure we stay away from that door. Why do you think I'm cursed? I never did anything wrong. Lady Michelle has lost her mind. She's deranged. Yeah, 4 days without water will do that to a person. I'm scared even thinking about her. I am not deranged. My mind is perfectly fine. She's right crazy. She's right mad. Nope, I'm not. I'm perfectly normal. Someone, please get me out of here. Is this where Morgana shows up? Because I'm having difficulty thinking of anyone else who is gonna, like, jailbreak him. Maybe George's. The fifth and then the sixth day passed, and by that point, I was hovering on death's brink. I lacked even the willpower to hold myself up against the door, so I simply lay on the cold floor, waiting for the end. I felt no sorrow, no anger, no despair, nothing. I had been sucked completely dry. I couldn't even compose a coherent thought, which is why, when the door I had so yearned to open actually did, and someone stepped inside, standing over me, I was unable to process it. So, my guess is either George's, who's come to free him, or this is where the dad goes for the murder. My god, what a mess. Hey, are you still alive? Well, look at that. I was afraid you'd be dead. It was Amy's voice. Oh, huh. That was unexpected. I'm sorry, really. I didn't mean you much harm. But after what you said in front of the whole family, I was a little upset. I couldn't tell what she was saying. Oh, right, because you outed her for her cheating. All I could hear were garbled sounds. All I could do was moan at her. The servants are all afraid of you now after your little episode. I volunteered to bring you your food in their place. Everyone was so grateful.
I don't think anyone likes you anymore. Eventually, my muddy mind managed to make sense of the thing she was holding in her hands. A tray of food. I could smell it from here. At first, I just gave your food to a stray cat. I wish you could have seen it devouring every last bite. Amy, you're a dick.
Water.
What I didn't know, though, was that people can die in just a few days without water. I never intended to kill you. I just didn't know. So I'm really sorry about that.
Water.
You're alive. For someone so physically weak, you sure are tenacious. Isn't that nice? You have one thing you can be proud of.
Water.
What was that? Water? You want water? Hold on, I've got some right here. She picked up a goblet with her delicate fingers. If she pours it all over the ground, I'm gonna be a little bit upset at her. My hand swiped weakly at the air, trying to grab it. A grin spread across her lips, and then she let go. Damn it, Amy! Why are you doing this? Why are you the way you are? Go on, drink. You better hurry or the rug will absorb it all. You wanted water, didn't you? Then drink. In that moment, I could hear the sound of the last of my dignity crumbling away. Driven solely by my survival instinct, I bent down toward the rug, pressing my lips against the spreading puddle.
Ha ha ha! You really did it! This is too good, Michelle. You look like a cat.
No, cats are much more graceful.
I can't stop laughing. The daughter of a prestigious family, the Bollingers, sucking water out of a carpet.
Ah, I wish I had a painter here to capture this image on canvas. So you know, I accept that I made a mistake, Michelle. I promise I'll be bringing your food from now on. I'll take very good care of you.
This is gonna be fun.
Listening to her childish, yet deeply malicious laughter, I understood. I was her plaything now. My hell was only just beginning. Having gotten food and water, my body recovered somewhat. But I was hardly in peak condition. It would take some time, given how badly malnourished I had been. Amy had continued to treat me like her pet, constantly stoking the flame of rage within me. I mean, the good news is we have foreshadowing, right? Where they went into no small amount of detail they intentionally brought up the fact that men are pretty much not categorically, but on average, meaningfully physically stronger than women. So we have that as, foreshadowing for Michael, physically overpowering her and making his grand escape. But I was too weak to stay on my feet for long, and talking hurt my throat. I assume it was a calculated effort on her part to maintain power over me, to keep me as miserable as possible. She always had a smirk on her face as she gazed down on me. Come on, open up. Today I'm gonna feed you myself. What's the matter? I can't put anything in with your mouth closed. Or do you want to starve to death?
Amy, why are you doing this?
Why? Because it's fun, why else? You married into this family, you sick wench. What gives you the idea you can treat me? Are you saying that because I married in, I'm of lesser stature than you? That's true, I am. But what's your point? You think you can intimidate me with formalities?
Amy.
Ew, I would rather you not speak my name if you wouldn't mind. That doesn't excuse your treatment of me. Someone, Diddy or George's, will make you pay for this. You don't have a single friend here, Michelle. No one to take your side. And no one to say a thing about me playing with you. Assuming you were somehow able to tell someone, no one would believe you.
It's a lie.
Do you have any idea what people say about you? They say you've gone mad. They say you sold your soul to the devil. Do you honestly believe anyone would trust you?
I am not mad.
I don't know, you look plenty mad to me.
Ah, fine, then I'll run away.
I'll escape from this estate, and from you. You think you could survive out in the world with that body? A stray cat could lift more than you. You'd never find work. I give you a week at best.
You can't be so sure of that.
Maybe I could make it on my own. Maybe, but either way, there's no way you're getting out. You try to run, someone might just cut your legs off.
How is that at all necessary?
Don't ask me. Maybe because your curse hasn't broken? You know, you're lucky you're even allowed to live. And you should be grateful for me for volunteering to take care of you. No one else wanted to have anything to do with it. So if you want to keep living, you have to show me some respect, and you have to do everything I tell you to. Understood?
So this is the real you.
You were just pretending to be respectable. When in reality, not only are you sleeping with Didier, you're a downright vile woman. Okay, so while I can respect your feelings here, Michael, actively insulting the person who is toying with your life, not necessarily the best strategy.
makes me wonder how you're as good at chess as you are. Maybe it's just that Didier sucks. You've been putting on an act ever since you got here. Oh, you make it sound like I'm somehow worse than anyone else. I'm quite normal, thank you. How is this normal? Listen to me, Michelle. The side of me you see right now isn't necessarily the whole thing. The sweet girl I am for the family is also me. And when I held you in my arms, that too was me. I'm not putting on an act. Liar. Although, to tell you the truth, I never actually liked you, so that part was a lie, yes. If Mother hadn't asked, I would never have even considered getting friendly with you. Amy. You know, life as a noble woman is so dull. So restrictive. No room for love at all. So can you really blame me? They're so happened to be the most wonderful knight right here, right there for the taking. Why shouldn't I have gone after him? I'm still young. Let me have some fun, you know? Not like women have much else in the way of recreation. So it wasn't Didier, but you who seduced him? And it all would have worked out beautifully, too, if you'd only kept your mouth shut. You've ruined our family gathering and damaged my reputation. And you called me a whore. That wasn't very nice, now was it? Is it any surprise I'm a little sore? You brought this on yourself, Michelle.
I brought this on myself? Don't you dare. Nothing justifies what you're doing to me. I'm not the disturbed one. You're a crazy whore, and don't you try and pretend otherwise, damn you.
Oh my, such language. You're not being very nice to me, Michelle. Girls aren't supposed to talk like that, you know.
I am not a girl.
And what are you?
I'm a man.
A man? With that body. Amy quietly rose, grabbed me by the hair, and shoved me to the floor.
Let go of me.
You call yourself a man? You can't even get out of a girl's grip. I think that has something to do with the starvation.
Gah.
I'm not all that strong, either. In fact, I'd say I'm rather weak. Just a small, powerless girl. If you were a man, you would have no problem breaking free, malnourished or otherwise. But you can't.
Ah, yet.
She traced a line of my emaciated ribs with her nails, traveling slowly, slowly, down my chest. But even ignoring that, you're missing the most important part.
So stop. Get off me.
I tried to shove her aside with all the strength I could squeeze out of my arms, but as Amy had said, I couldn't even overpower a girl. All I could do was lay there beneath her and beg,
get off me,
groaning in anger and frustration. Her finger came to a stop just above my navel. She looked up at me with a sweet smile, and then pulled her hand away. And just as a wave of relief spread through me, she shoved me back, jumped up, and slammed her foot between my legs.
Oh, God, don't do that.
Ugh! I shuddered as the pain jolted up my spine. Amy looked down at me as I screamed. A smirk spread across her face. Oh my, does that hurt?
There's a surprise. Even with that boy part, it still hurts.
Stop, please. And she didn't stop at stepping on me.
I'm begging you, stop, please.
She dug her toes into my flesh. What are you exactly, Michelle? From the feel of it, you don't quite have proper girl parts either.
Amy, please.
On top of the physical pain, unbearable humiliation and shame corroded away at my spirit. What a strange creature you are.
Stop.
If I could have died right there and then, honestly, that would have been preferable to the emotional hell she was putting me through. You should take a look at yourself in a mirror, Michelle. You're crying, sobbing like a sad little girl. Not much of a boy, are you?
And you lusted after me? With this body?
Seriously. You're disgusting. I can't believe you actually had the gall to fall for me. Amy's abuse was not a one-time occurrence. As she had promised, she came to feed me every day, but her arrival brought nothing but anguish and torture. Every day, she chipped away more of my spirit, but I hadn't succumbed to her yet. My anger still overpowered any fear I felt. About a week after Amy started caring for me. Have you been a good girl, Michelle? I brought you your supper. I'll set it right here for you. What's the matter, Michelle? Your food's right there. It's going to get cold. Go on, eat. But no using your hands. Crawl over and use your mouth. Come on, eat. Would you rather I fed you?
You.
What was that? You have something to say?
I
can't understand a word you're saying, Michelle. If you would eat, you would have enough strength to talk.
Oh, you.
Hmm?
Going to kill you, Amy.
That was, I believe, the first time in my life I felt a sincere, overpowering desire to end someone's life. I wanted to see her dead.
with my hands and legs tied up. With my hands and legs tied up, I lurched for her, and like the dog she had so wanted me to be, I chomped down on her wrist.
Ah!
The taste of someone else's blood was far more unpleasant than I had expected. I felt like I was going to vomit. But I was determined to not let go of her wrist for any reason. I would gnaw through to the bone and rip her entire hand off. She could beat me unconscious and I still wouldn't let go. She would have to kill me to get me off of her. I wanted her to feel the same pain I felt. She trampled on me.
Let go!
My body never did what I wanted it to, though. I could swear in my life I wouldn't release her arm, but I could never seem to make good on my determination.
So, amusingly, this is also feeds into the reason why Michael was reticent about talking about his first crush, because it ended rather poorly.
Amy's foot flew up into my emaciated gut. The pointed tip of her shoe dug into my flesh like a knife, and I collapsed to the floor in a fit of convulsions. And just as I was about to cough up a mouthful of stomach acid, she rammed her foot into my abdomen a second time. She didn't even give me enough time to get to my feet, let alone fight back, before she kicked me again. Again and again and again and again.
Stop.
My gut, my chest, my legs, and my face. What's wrong with you? Don't you get it? You're not the one in control here. You should be thanking me. What you did to me that day was incredibly hurtful. And here I am, bringing you your food. Can you not see just how kind-hearted I am? So why would you go and bite me? What would possess you to do such a thing? Gasping for breath, my consciousness slipping away from me, I caught a glimpse of Amy's eyes as she swung her leg back for another kick. And when I did, a single word rose to my mind. Demon.
Haha, isn't that something? You can't even stand up to a girl.
I'm not that strong. I'm weak and frail. This is the first time I've ever kicked someone. I have absolute control over you, Michelle. You understand that now, right? You learned your lesson, didn't you? Not an ounce of strength remained within me. My tongue and cheeks were torn up, and my mouth tasted of blood.
It's kind of interesting that, like, even after this, Michael maintains to Morgana that revenge is, like, not the answer. I would definitely be in, like, full revenge mode, like, several weeks before here.
An ounce of strength remained within me. My tongue and cheeks were torn up, and my mouth tasted of blood. Thinking herself weak and having no experience in the ways of physical violence, she knew no restraint. The ignorant can be so much more brutal and viciously relentless than the seasoned. My vision had gone red, and I could hardly feel my own face. There was a strange gurgling sound with every breath I took.
Ah, jeez, what am I going to do about this hand? It hurts like crazy.
Oh, I know. I'll tell everyone you finally lost it and tried to bite my hand off.
They'll all feel so bad for me. I can just see the sad looks on Didier and George's faces.
They will not.
You know, your brothers have completely given up on you. A deranged sister is nothing but trouble. You know what you are, Michelle? You're a demon child. Why was I the demon and not her? Why did no one come to my aid? Several times I considered ending my life, but every time I did, memories of better days came back to me. Of the time before my body had transformed. The days when we were all so sure of our happiness kept me chained to life. Why couldn't things still be the way they had been then? In my heart, I hadn't changed it at all. How had things ended up like this?
Michelle? Oh, Michelle! Are you in there?
You need something, Georges?
Oh, come on, don't be like that.
Do I have to need something to talk to you?
Man, I got baited super hard. And, like, the writers knew exactly what they were doing, too. They were like, oh, hey, we're gonna have a scene where Georges goes in and, like, checks on Michelle. And it'll be hilarious, because they'll think it was in the present. And then it's a flashback. Got baited.
No, but you look like you were in an unusually good mood, so I thought,
well, why wouldn't I be? It's a wonderfully gloomy day out.
I can understand if it were clear out, but can you really say it's wonderfully gloomy?
Well, you can't be outside for very long when it's not cloudy, so in our case, this is perfect weather.
Ah. What do you say if we go for a little stroll while we can?
He's around today, too, so we can see if he's up for it. It'll be like old times.
We've been running around like headless chickens lately, so we haven't had much of a chance for a sibling outing. We'll have Mom make us lunch, and then... Ooh, we'll take a couple horses up to the forest's edge.
I'm fine with that if you are.
You bet your bum I am. I asked, after all. Now come on, let's go. An outing, you say? Yep, yep. Hop on a couple horses and head for the forest. You haven't done this in a while, so I figured why not? I see. Well, if Michelle is coming, I see no reason to say no. Wait, the subtle digs? If it's, like, just you, then why the hell would I want to spend the day with my brother? Let's set off right away. Whoa, slow down there. Are you saying you wouldn't go if it was just me? Yeah, I got that too. It's Michelle or nothing? Of course. Why on earth would I want to go on a horse riding alone with you? I'd rather drown myself. That's a little harsh. Lee gasp! Didier, could I perhaps make a small request? Go on, let's hear it. Do you mind if I hold the horse's reins? Oh, that's all? By all means. I'll be there behind you to make sure nothing happens, so have at it. But do be warned, my horse is a bit temperamental. If you're not gentle, he'll start getting moody with you. I doubt that'll be a problem for you, though, Michelle. I'll be careful. Hey, whoa, slow down, guys. Aha, look at that, Michelle. George is still fumbling around all the way back there. Are we going a bit too fast? No, you're fine. That you're able to get past that so quickly is proof of your talent. Ah, finally caught up. This isn't a race, you know. Why can't we enjoy the scenery, indulging in some nice pathos? The warrior and his horse need not have pathos. Isn't that right, Michelle? It certainly is, Didier. Come on, you guys! Be nice! This is my idea! You've really taken after old D, haven't you, Michelle? I, for one, would rather see you admiring flowers, or dancing with butterflies, or gazing out at a beautiful sunset, or enjoying poetry. More pathos, my dear sister, and less barbarism. Longswords, suits of armor, and tales of heroic knights are so much more appealing, though. You've let him get his claws in too deep, Michelle. Oh dear, oh my, I'm going to have two meathead siblings before I know it. What did you just call me? Now, you two. Why don't we stop here for a picnic? Seconded. My stomach's been rumbling up a storm. I took a few bites earlier because I was about to die back there. I hope your horse throws you into a river. Hey, so the other day, I brought a cat home. A cat? Yep, speckled from head to tail and ugly as a witch's arse. I was gonna keep it in my room, but Mom flicked when she saw it. Keep that filthy thing out of my house. Wish there was something we could do about how much of a clean freak she is. George's, try not to stress Mother too much. You're unpredictable enough as it is. It would be nice, though, to have a cat, I mean. You think so? How about this? We keep it in the courtyard. I'll feed it on days when it's clear, and you can do it when it's cloudy, Michelle. I don't know what cats eat, though. I bet he likes pastries. Have you met a cat before? Do you want to kill the cursed thing? I cannot approve of anyone taking care of an animal who thinks that's a good idea. Yeah, I'm with Didier on this one. Sorry, oh wait. It's George's who says pastries. Yeah, George's, you're a dumbass. You're a lovable dumbass, but you're a dumbass. Oh, pull the stick out of your arse, D. Life's all about experimentation. Yeah, so experimentation on the diet of your pets is perhaps not a great idea. Like, you are liable to actually get them killed. Live and learn. Don't experiment on animals. See, Didier is the voice of reason here. I like Didier. Well, if you're gonna be like that, how about you help out too? You can keep an eye on us and make sure we don't do anything stupid. What, now you're trying to drag me into this? Already done. You're in. It's settled. Damn it, Georges. Now we need to come up with a name. Have any ideas, Michelle? What, you want me to name it? I swear to God, if it's like Morgana or something, I'm gonna flip shit. Not very often you get to give it another living thing a name. Well, I guess you might have a few more chances down the road. Consider this practice. Something elegant and beautiful. You got this. Now George's. Don't put so much pressure on her. You have a point, though. It is a good opportunity. Don't stress too much about it, Michelle. Just choose something you like. You said the cat was speckled and ugly? Yep. One look and you'll be laughing so hard you can't breathe. Alright then. Ugly speckles. That's its name? It would seem you do not have a future in the arts, Michelle. But you said it was ugly and speckled, Georges. I did, yes. Could have tried a little harder than that, though. But, you know, why not? Ugly speckles it is. It's actually kind of charming when you say it out loud. Ugly speckles. It's not that funny. It is quite something indeed. The more I think about it, the more I... Not you too, Didier. We should bring ugly speckles on our next outing. Sitting together beneath the clouds, having lunch. That we should. When Michelle's gotten a bit bigger, let's do this again. The three of us and our ugly speckled cat. You said it. We're all good friends here, after all. I've never been your friend, though. God, must you always be such a jerk? Didier. George's. Was Amy telling the truth? Do you really think nothing but trouble? Do you think I've lost my mind? That I'm a demon child? Didier. George's. Why do you not open this door for me and let me out? Were the things I said that day really so heinous? Do you resent me too, like Amy? Didier. George's. How do you think about me now? Is this body really so unusual? If I hadn't undergone the transformation I did, would things still have been the way they were before? Would we be able to go out to that forest again and make silly, meaningless conversation, everyone laughing like we had then? If this body hadn't changed the way it did, would I not be trapped in this darkness? Even if that were the case, I didn't want to be a girl. If God descended from heaven and offered to change me back, I would have turned him down. Because inside, I wasn't a girl. And my nightmare at Amy's hands didn't end there, either. As much as I loathed to admit it, I was terrified of her. Every day, I dreaded the sound of the door opening. However, if I were to block the door off with furniture, I would lose my only remaining lifeline. I had no choice in the matter. It's time for supper, Michelle. I brought your favorite, parsnips. Well, what the dogs didn't eat of them, anyway. But you don't mind, do you? I'm going to cut your nails today, Michelle. I need you to stay very still. You wouldn't want my hands to slip. So to make sure you do, I'm tying you up. That way, you can't accidentally move. Here's your water, Michelle. It's murky? Oh, heavens me, I must have fetched it from the wash basin by mistake. It's supper time, Michelle. I brought you parsnips again. Don't worry, the dogs didn't have any of these. They didn't seem to be interested in eating them raw. What, you don't want any? Then what am I going to do with these? You know, Michelle, you're such a disgrace. Cry for me, won't you? Beg for mercy. Ha ha ha! Look at you, all that pride. Gone out the window. It's hilarious, I tell you. She did everything imaginable to torture me, both physically and emotionally. To be honest, it was rather impressive, in a sick way, how she was able to come up with so many different ways to torment me. And she knew precisely what caused me the most pain. My body, and the discrepancy between what I was and what I felt I was. She delighted in telling me I wasn't male, and sometimes, in showing me. But I don't think I need to describe the things she did to me in any more detail. I could think of only one way to keep myself from breaking down. I completely stopped talking, stopped struggling. Then, one day, after about 6 months or so, she said with a disinterested sigh, "I'm done," and that was the last of it. By swallowing my pride and not resisting, I was able to escape from her grip. Once she was gone, servants took over attending to me again. I was still imprisoned, but now there was a serenity in my solitude. I didn't speak with anyone. I didn't make eye contact. I didn't do anything. I just lived. But even though I had peace, I still feared Amy having a change of heart. I trembled at the possibility that one day it might be her that opened the door. But above all, I hated, despised the fact that I lived in such fear of a girl. An overwhelming self-loathing threatened to crush me. I had recurring nightmares about the things Amy had done to me. The wounds she gave me did not heal. They only grew worse, eating away at me day after day. I was beginning to lose confidence in my own sanity in the silent darkness, where there was no sense of time. The line between dream and reality blurred. I often found myself screaming, crying into the empty air. I clawed at my skin, pulled out my hair, paced back and forth across the room, pounded at the door, yelling for help, screamed some more. It was the very image of pitiful, absolute wretchedness. Every time I did, I'm sure there was someone on the other side of that door, whispering about how poor Michelle had lost her mind. Eventually, I gave up entirely. It was a stormy night in my 16th year. I'd been confined for more than 2 years at the point. 2 years? Jesus. Heavy rain pounded against the windows like thousands of little spears. I was sitting quietly on my bed, unable to fall asleep, when suddenly, there was a loud banging on the door. Michael! Michael, are you awake? If you aren't, then hurry up and get awake! We've got big trouble! Lower your damn voice! But... when I first heard my brother's voices after so long, I thought I was hallucinating. 2 years, they had never once come for me, no matter how hard I pounded on the door, no matter how many times I called for them. And after all that time, I didn't expect that to ever change. I'd given up, assumed they had long since cast me aside. Unable to bring myself to say anything, I simply stared at the door, when there was another bam, bam. The sound was half consumed by a crack of thunder, giving it an indescribably eerie quality. Say something, Michael? Seriously, there's no time. You can hear us in there, can't you? You're there behind the door, aren't you? Come on, just one word, Michael. Is it really you, Didier, George's?
For a moment, they seemed to be at a loss for words, probably because they almost didn't recognize my voice. But it was only a heartbeat, and then Didier spoke. There's a carriage waiting outside. I'm going to unlock the door so you can leave in it. Why? Because Dad's talking crazy. He's saying the Bollinger family has no need for a demon child, that you're a mark of shame on our name. He was going to have you executed. So, here's the question. Like, do they get props for this, or do they get, like... Or should they be admonished for, like, putting up with this for 2 years? It was only the thought of their brother, like, actually getting killed that drove them to action. Like, this is some fucked up shit. Actually, no, never mind. Come to think of it, like, sticking him off in the mansion is functionally the same environment as this, right? Just a little bit larger. So if they didn't know what Amy was doing to him, like, I guess it's not that different. I don't know. I kind of want to put more of an onus on them to, like, do something and not wait 2 years to do it. George's father wants me dead? Felt like the floor had fallen out from under me. Executed? Demon child? Mark of shame? So he was saying, I didn't even deserve to live anymore? It's planned for tomorrow morning. We only just found out ourselves, which is why... You prepared a way for me to escape? But why? Why? Do you need to ask? Because we're family. Something terrible has gotten into Father. I clenched my teeth, fighting back a bitter, angry sigh. But I couldn't keep all those emotions bottled up for long. A maelstrom of feelings I thought I had lost in my 2 years of imprisonment swirled up inside me, spilling from my lips. Why? Why are you doing this now? If you really felt that way, then why didn't you come sooner? 2 years I spent locked in this room. Do you have any idea how I felt in that time? Any idea how hard I tried to fight to endure? How many times I cried for your help? How hard I pounded on the door, begging to be set free? But never, never once did you come. Not even once. Michael, I scare you, don't I? You think I've gone insane, that I've lost my mind, that I sold my soul to the devil, don't you? No, Michael, we don't... Then why? Why didn't you come and set me free? Michael, we don't think you've lost your mind at all. So you didn't want to see me then. You didn't want to face what I'd become. Tell me I'm wrong, Didier, Georges. You left me here, abandoned me, for 2 whole years. Locked me away so you didn't have to see me. I'm sorry. I'm just, you know, really busy with my... What kind of shitty-ass excuse is that? Busy with your art? Come the fuck on! I've been getting a ton of commissions down to the court. And Didier's a knight now, you know? He's up to his next in expeditions. I'm really sorry. As am I. I cannot say that you are wrong. After what happened, I wasn't sure how I was supposed to act around you. I'm still not sure, even now. I knew I had to find the time to collect myself, but I kept putting it off, mainly hoping the time would take care of it. And for that, I owe you an apology. But you need to understand, I do not agree with Father's decision. I do not want to lose you. I don't think you're a demon child. And George's feels the same. Either of us wants to see you dead. What he said, Michael. There's not much time. We need to get you out of there. I bit down hard on my lower lip, hard enough to draw blood. It was that, or start sobbing. It's a little late for that. Michael, if you don't get out of here, you're going to be killed. I'm not an angel sent from heaven, or a demon child. What am I? What on earth am I? What are you? You're a Bollinger. You're our family. That's all there is to it. I pray... You can forgive me for averting my eyes for so long. Can I trust you? Can I trust that even if the whole world says I'm cursed, that you'll always be on my side? That you'll always be my brothers? Can I put my trust in you once more, Didier, Georges? You absolutely can, Michael. I swear to God on high. And I swear to the God of Art. Michael, I have no other choice, do I? I couldn't talk Father out of it, could I? I would rather you didn't try. He's not a man to change his mind. If you were to show up before him, he would likely draw a sword on you himself. He would destroy Mother. I'm sorry, we're not doing this only for you. Okay, I'll go. Oh, thank goodness. The carriage will take you to a mansion, Michael. It's a property Father purchased some time ago. But due to rumors about the house, it's abandoned. No one wants to buy it from him either, and that's unlikely to change. It's an ideal place to keep you out of sight. What kind of rumors? No point in keeping it a secret. He has a right to know. They say a witch lives there. A witch? I think it's all just made up, personally. I went to check the place out, and there was no one there. It was a little dreary, to be sure. I'd hoped to have a better place arranged for you, but
there wasn't enough time. This is only temporary, Michael. I cannot say how long it will be. A decade. But Father will pass away eventually. When he does, George will inherit the estate. And that will mean you can return. So I ask that you hold out until that time. If I don't leave, I'm going to be executed. So send me anywhere. I won't complain. I'm glad to hear you say that. I will talk to Father and ensure he does not suspect anything. We'll make this work, don't you worry. The long and short of it is, Dad simply wants you erased from the family. George's! Sorry. I was trying to be mean. But anywho, once I take over, we're in the clear. You'll be acknowledged as a Bollinger. I see. Okay, then. Can I open the door now? Just a minute. You're still not ready? I don't have any clothing. Right. You wouldn't, huh? How tall are you now, Michael? Around the same height as you, I think. You're taller than me? Damn. Alright, I'll bring you some of my clothes. Thank you. Wow, I don't think I've ever heard you say thank you without putting up a fight, Michael. That's not true. I don't think. Haha. I'll be back soon. Get what you need together. Alright. But I guess at the end of the day, they did jailbreak him, so they get some credit for that. Sitting in the carriage waiting outside, listening to the pitter-patter of the rain, I gazed out at my two brothers. I hadn't seen them in 2 years, but they hardly looked any different than how I remembered them. I was the only one who had changed, dramatically at that. Looking at them, I couldn't help but remember the old days, playing chess with Didier, learning to draw from George's, our sibling outings. However, the ominous sound of thunder crashing in the distance drowned all those memories. Imagine several days' travel from here. Hopefully the carriage isn't too uncomfortable. I'll send a package with any supplies you need once a month. Food, clothing, and something to pass the time. If there's anything you want, Michael, just tell me. Now, or you can have a servant pass a message on to me. I can think of one thing. I would like a chess set. Alright, I'll have one made. I would rather have yours, Didier. Would that be possible? Are you sure you want that beaten old thing? Yes, I want that one. Alright then, I'll include it in the first delivery. I'll send you something too, Michael. Oh, it's George's in the painting! That makes sense! Well then, where's Didier? Anything you want, just tell me. In that case, I would like some art tools. I'm nowhere near as much of an artist as you are, George's. They don't have to be anything special. Gotcha, so some canvas and, how about some charcoal? When you're back, I want to see what you made with it, okay? Okay. I know this is already hard enough on you, Michael, but I need to ask you to do something for me. Avoid making contact with anyone who doesn't already know about you. So I can't talk to anyone but the servants? Put simply, yes. Tomorrow, the world will consider you dead, so you cannot have people finding out that you are actually alive. Especially Father. Please do this for me. I've been doing that for 2 years already. I've long since lost interest in interacting with anybody, so you don't need to ask me to keep to myself. Right. Does anyone else know I'm alive? Yes, Mother knows. In fact, this was her idea. It was? She loves you, Michael, she really does. Mom just, is having a little trouble facing the truth. Even though she's not here to see you off, I guarantee she doesn't want to see you dead. She wants to have you in her life again. I expect Mother will be writing you, so please, take the time to write her back. She's a troubled woman, but her love for you is true and unwavering. Will you do that? Just a quick little, hey, got your letter, doing great, will suffice. Alright. Just so you know, it kills me indeed that we can't stand up to Dad. But as long as he lives, his word is God in this house. I understand that, yes. Well, he could be gone quicker than you expect. A week from now and bam, he's dead as D's social life. Oof. Is there not an ounce of respect in your body? Oh, give me a break, I'm upset. He's gone way too far. And once he's dragged his arse off to the great beyond, anything goes. Surprise, Michael is alive! Yeah, I suppose. Until then, we'll take care of things here. Tomorrow's gonna be the performance of our lives. Crying like a couple of big babies and laughing our tails off inside. You'll forgive me if I have trouble trusting that loose tongue of yours. Psh, I'm not stupid. I know this is important. Not even Amy will suspect a thing. Amy. Yeah, not even she can know. It's gonna crush her, I'm sure, but the less people who know, the better. When Georgia said her name, my whole body went shamefully cold. It had been a year and a half since the hell she'd put me through, but every last detail of it remained carved into my mind and body. There was no way she would even be slightly sad about my death. She might act it, but she would almost certainly be elated by the news. Team George's had still yet to see what lay beyond, beneath that woman's mask. Okay, this is really loud. I know you two were close.
Huh?
Are you worried about how this might affect her?
What?
She cared for you for about 6 months, didn't she? When you wouldn't let the servants in.
What?
What I hear, you got real close to dying in there. You wouldn't even eat unless she was there.
Who the hell told you that?
What? Is that not what happened? Something happened between you two, Michael?
Amy, you mean into a dam?
Never mind. I can't tell them. I can't put what I went through into words. It'll only worsen the shame. Especially not in front of my brothers. Georges, how are things between you and Amy? Still letting what happened 2 years ago get to you? I mean, at the time, things were a total disaster. I'm all excited about getting myself a pretty little wife, only to find out she's rocking the boat with someone else. Cried for weeks.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Deep down, though, she ain't actually a bad girl. She's young, and kids make mistakes. And mistakes like torturing someone for 6 months.
Ha ha!
After it all came out, she turned over a new leaf. She started doting on me something serious, and, well, it's hard not to let one little mistake like that go when she's trying so hard to make up with me. The age excuse doesn't work for Dee, though. For about a year, things were really rough between us. I didn't even want to look at him. But at the end of the day, we're family. We can get past anything. Besides, because you let the cat out of the bag, that gave me something to hold over Dee. All things considered, I'm not complaining. So, you would say you're happy then, Georges? Sure would, yep. Believe it or not, I'm kinda head over heels for her. Hard not to like a girl like Amy. No, I see. You really feel that bad about 2 years ago? So she's still keeping up the good girl facade around Georges and Didier. No one else knows. She's actually a sadistic, cackling demon. There's nothing less trustworthy in this world than a woman who's always smiling. Ah, like Giselle. But if Georges thinks he's happy, I can't take that away from him. That definitely explains a non-0% of the initial distrust towards Giselle. Like, almost makes me want to go back and reread Door 5 with the fresh context on really both of them. Michael? Oh, right, yes. I do feel guilty about the way I lost control of my emotions and took it out on you guys. Happens to everyone. In fact, you could stand to do a little more shouting and fussing. Then you could, because I have underdeveloped social skills. You heard that? Got one hell of a nasty streak, huh, Dee? I'm glad to hear you're still on good terms. It wasn't my intention to put the two of you against each other. We know. The blame falls on my shoulders. I want you to know something, Michael. Though your transformation was too much for mother and father to accept, with enough time, everything will go back to the way it was before, just like it did for myself and George's. None of this is your fault. It was all unfortunate timing. God's a little bit of a jerk, too. Try not to forget I am a knight, Georges. In time. Speaking of which, we don't have much left. I'm gonna tell the coachman to set off, okay? Didier. Yes? Tell me the truth. Will the three of us ever meet again? Why would you ever ask that? Of course we will. Not a chance I'm letting this be our last family get-together. One last question, then. Yes? Am I your brother? Well, I mean, look at you. Don't look like much of a sister to me. So yeah, I'd say you are. I see. So long, then. Farewell. May good health bless you until we meet again. Till then, Michael. Farewell. Before seeing me off for good, they both gave me strong, firm hugs. Didier first, and then George's. The warmth I felt in their arms, my family's arms, slowly spread through my chilled body, which made it that much more difficult to part ways. The wheels of the carriage rattled against this wet, stone-paved road. I stuck my head out the window, watching as they shrunk into the distance, standing there in the rain until they were completely out of view. A tightness filled my breast. Every glimmer of hope I had for my new life was matched by an equal degree of darkness and uncertainty. Would I ever make it back home? If I did, people still call me a demon child? Having to write Mother was another uncomfortable weight on my soul. The thought of having to play a girl for her made me sick. George's had acted like it would be nothing, but it wasn't that easy. It was more than mere pretend. Didier had said that, with time, things would change. But how could he be certain that those changes would be for the better? The wooden wheels turned, carrying me away to that cursed mansion. The next thing I know, I'm sinking into a vast void. Darkness cuffs my hands and legs. restricting my movement. Images of the past I'd kept buried away for so long streamed past me. This isn't how I wanted it to happen. Not coming from my own mouth, but being laid bare for all to see without my consent. This wasn't how I wanted her to find out about my secret, about my shameful history. I warned you, my dear. I told you you didn't want to reclaim your old self. If you'd simply let it be, you wouldn't be here now, forced to relive it all. Now do you understand? The tale I spun behind the fourth door was as much for you as it was for her. There, you were a young man with a sad fate, but you met a wonderful woman, fell in love with her, and then died in the arms of tragedy. The sequence of events is not far from the truth, but I was able to turn it into something enchanting and beautiful. I got rid of all the nasty little details, your ugliness, your body troubles, all of that. Doesn't it seem a bit unfair, Michael? You tore down the walls around Giselle's heart, around her past, but you wanted to keep your own nice and safe and hidden away. She has every right to be upset. You were afraid she wouldn't accept you, were you not? And that's precisely what happened. Can you honestly blame her? The truth you've kept hidden away is not something most would be able to accept. The prince who came riding in to save her...
Silence!
...wasn't actually a man.
Please. Enough. I've seen enough. Let it stay buried, please.
Just stop this. I don't want to see it. I don't want anything to do with it. What a sad little creature you are, my dear. Not a woman in this world would have any interest in you now. You surrounded yourself with layer upon layer of walls, covered yourself with this patchwork, barely held together quilt of masks, and it's the only thing keeping you together. You're the frailest one of all, the weakest. And it's about time you accepted that and stopped trying to fight it.
I am not weak.
Oh, is that so? Let's proceed with the tale then, shall we? Face the one you hate most in the world, yourself, your weakness, your ugliness. Face it in despair.
Don't!
Again. Once again, my own desires, my own wishes are completely irrelevant. The past crawls out before me once more, and the witch is exactly right. I despise the man I was then, teeming with vain hope and foolish dreams. I would rather pretend that part of me never existed, but I have no choice. I'm dragged back into the life I once loved, my pleas for mercy fading into dark nothingness. And we will be leaving the rest of Door 7 for another day. I said it was going to be a short video, but we still almost ended up at 2 hours. So that, I guess, goes to show you how good I am at keeping promises. So on that sombering note, I will be signing off. I've been Teo. It's been the House in Fata Morgana. And I will catch you all next time. I'm going to use catch now, because then I don't have to use the awkward, like, sight verb when I don't actually get to see any of you. So catch. Catch is, I think, what I'm going to go from now on. Anyhow, now that I've settled on that, later. Peace.